You're listening to the Miss Artastic Podcast, inspiration for art teachers. Here's your host, Kathleen McGivern.
Hello, my lovely friends. I am your host, Kathleen McGivern, founder of All Things Miss Artastic. Today, we're going to talk a bit about reflective teaching practices, and this is a topic that I need to focus on as well. It is so often that we feel alone in our classrooms, offices, or studios. We show up, do the work, and go home. Sometimes we have colleagues, but it's not all the time that we see them. As well, they may know you well, but they might not know what is happening inside your classroom or your office or studio. I think that it's important that we remind ourselves of the magic makers in our lives, which are ourselves. When I was in my educational program in university, we were often asked to reflect and write reflections. I was only 20 at the time, and as you can imagine, I didn't take this seriously. I didn't see the value or the importance. As well, times were different over a decade ago. We didn't explore growth mindset, social emotional learning, and well-being, and we didn't really talk too much about mental health and well-being in schools or my educational program. As a student teacher, I was asked to reflect after observations as well. And as a good student, I rambled off reflections of things I did well and things I could work on next time, and off I went. To be honest, I wasn't really doing the work of reflecting. I was just saying it. I was focused on jumping through the hoops and getting to my second stage at university complete. I just wanted it all done. As well, I had someone else there to cheer me on and show me my accomplishments. I had a practicum teacher and a university professor holding my hand, giving me high fives and gold stars. My achievements and growth were naturally visible to me because, of course, we were, doing all the show and shares at university and all that jazz. However, once we were out of that blissful bubble of glitter, sparkles, and rainbows, the cheerleading squads faded into the shadows, and then you're hired into the classroom, which you are both the captain of and the cheerleader. With the to-do list miles long, lesson planning to do, and ideas searching to be implemented, rooms to be organized, parent communication to be had, assessment and grading to be completed. There is only time in the day for captain and not enough time for cheerleader. As well, who has time for a moment of reflection when you have all this to do? That has been my thinking really until now. I realized that often when I don't feel like I'm ticking to-dos off my list fast enough, negative self-talk or chatter starts. This often also happens when I'm stressed or like overworked, tired, or even hungry. As well, it can loop into a dark, repetitive vortex of negativity when sometimes the only person I talk to about work is me. If I'm being negative, that inner voice I argue with cheers on the negativity and I begin to not focus on the magic that is around me, that I have encouraged, inspired, and created in my classroom or for Ms. Artastic Nation. And instead, I continue to focus on things that I'm upset about, which of course makes me more mad, more upset, and more stress. Reflect upon your present blessings, of which every man has many, not on your past misfortunes, of which all men have some. Charles Dickens. Reflection asks us to look at the big picture, to step back from ourselves and think about our actions and accomplishments critically. It helps us adjust our perspectives when we're stuck with our thinking and often self-sabotaging the situation, or investigate into whether emotions altered perspectives. As well, professional reflection or reflective teaching means that we take a look at what we do in our classrooms and think about why we do it. When we allow for professional reflection or reflective teaching, we encourage personal growth in our professional journeys. We can calibrate our instructional and teaching practices and pedagogy. We take the time to find and celebrate successes so that instead of being negative or staying stuck with our thinking, or even disallowing personal growth in our profession, we can instantly see all the successes we've had in our professional journey and develop a better version of ourselves. After I started reflecting, I began to grow more and develop that better version of myself. It helped me put things into perspective, allowed me to calibrate my teaching skills and art lesson crafting. It helped me grow and better my personal life and allowed me to feel more gratitude in my daily life. Reflecting allowed me to come to see that I was indeed getting a lot done. I was making huge progress and learning so much. In fact, I was also adding so much more to my to-do lists. So though it appeared like I wasn't marking off things quick enough, I actually was. The reality was that I was just adding more tasks on faster when I got ideas from daydreaming while driving to work or drinking my coffee in the morning, or that lovely moment when you get into bed and suddenly a billion ideas slide into your brain like an avalanche on a warm winter day. The reflective teaching process. So teaching reflectively is a process, but also this is a cycle that we can absorb into our own lives too. The steps of reflection are: teach a lesson or do the task that you want to reflect on or improve on. Next, pause and reflect on all the moments of the lesson. You can even video record yourself, teach, and then go back and watch it to see the bigger picture. And this can be in your own life as well, or other side hustles that you have, like working in your studio. You can think about the strengths during the lesson or task or activity and the things that could be improved on. Next, think about the new ways to teach this lesson or ways to improve on your instruction. And this is all about us thinking about ways to enable our own self-growth or professional growth, to encourage us to grow into our better versions of ourselves, whether on a personal level or as a studio instructor, art teacher, or whatever. Then, try your new ideas in practice. Teach the lesson. Finally, start that reflective process all over again. Teach, pause, and reflect. Think of new ways to teach the lesson or whatever. Try out your new ideas. Each time you're getting better and better, growing, allowing your growth journey or journey of success to accelerate. Each little win or step in your growth journey is a piece of your overall puzzle. And just imagine, sure, one improvement is one improvement to a lesson, but imagine all of it together over a year of reflective teaching. Decades? Imagine how far you could go. This is where the possibilities are endless. This is how you can get the best version or vision of yourself in any area of your life, even beyond your teaching practice. So now let's dive into ways you can reflect in your professional practice. The first one is called 3 stars and a wish. This is the one that I did as a student teacher. Again, at the time, I really did not like reflecting. I did not understand the growth part of it. I wasn't a teacher yet. I didn't understand growth mindset or any of that. What I'm saying is, I had a different mindset a decade ago. Who didn't? I too am on a professional and life journey. Upon reflecting, I can now see that this process makes a difference. I can also see that I need to make this happen in my Ms. Artastic life and in my own personal life as well, to encourage a better version of myself to develop. So 3 stars and a wish means that after teaching a lesson, leading an activity, or doing your task, you are going to reflect using this specific format. So you do the teaching, think about and consider the activity, and reflect with 3 stars and a wish. This means you're writing down in a journal or paper or typing it up on a digital journal. The 3 stars that you did really well during your lesson or instructional time, these are your 3 stars. So you will find one thing that you need to improve on, and that is your wish. Finally, you need to think of a new way to improve on your lesson or your wish. And of course, implement it into your next lesson. And then repeat, tweak, calibrate, slowly making it perfect. Next, you can ask the kids. So another idea is that after the instructional part of the lesson and while students are working, you can take your journal or notepad and stop and ask a few of the kids about one thing that they learned and if there was anything unclear in the lesson. You can be honest if you want and let them know that you're trying to improve on your teaching instruction or lessons, and that you basically, this is a way you can demonstrate that you too are a lifelong learner. So you can take notes and jot it down and use this as part of your reflection to help you understand where you need to improve your teaching strategies or instructional methods. Include it in your lesson plans. So another idea is that at the end of your lesson plan, maybe in the notes section, you can build it like right into the lesson plan template. So you can add your reflection section. It could even be titled Reflection. You can jot a few prompts to yourself like, what was successful during the lesson? Did students follow all the steps? Were the steps clear about the expectations? What is something that you can improve on next time? What can I do differently? Another idea is that you can film yourself. So teachers have a second pair of eyes watching them when they're being observed. But what about observing for personal growth? You can turn your computer camera on to record or set up your phone near you at the front so you're not filming the students and film just yourself teach. Then you can go back and see exactly what you are saying, what it sounds like to an observer, your mannerisms and your actions. You can listen to how you give instructions or expectations, and then you can decide on what you did well and celebrate those successes. And then think of what you want to improve on as part of your reflection. As always, be sure to implement your ideas for how to improve to allow yourself to take those steps toward your better version. Always tweak, always calibrate. Another idea is keeping a reflective journal. So you can keep a journal or notepad or notebook with you in your classroom that is dedicated purely to your reflections. This is kind of like your dear diary, except you're recording your thoughts, observations, goals, and ideas for improvement. In your journal or notebook, you can write down your thoughts, observations, or ideas about the lesson that you taught. Write down things that you notice, like things that you notice about what the students are doing or how they responded when you did something, whatever it might be. Write down the things that worked well and the things that weren't successful and need to be improved upon. Keeping a journal and writing down our observations creates a record of our learning journeys and allows us to look back at where we were, how far we have come, and it is a great way to present yourself with an opportunity to look back on your thoughts and ideas from the past. This documentation, by the way, is a great thing to bring with you to a job interview, telling the person who is doing the job interview that you strongly believe in and practice reflective teaching as part of your growth path in becoming the best or your best teacher version is a great thing to be able to say and prove. So try these strategies for a while and see how they help you both in your teaching practice, lessons, activities, or in your own life. Try this for at least a month and make it a habit. It is said that 66 days are needed as a minimum for creating a new habit in your life, or like 3 months. If you're a member of the Artastic Collective, you will also get access to my reflective teaching journal pages that you can print and put into your binder as part of one of the monthly lessons in the classroom, which is my year-long art teacher growth course that you get as part of your membership. If you want to share with me how you've been demonstrating your reflective teaching practices, then you can totally take a picture of your journal. Maybe you read or type out part of something that has gone well, that you learned from for the teaching practice or reflective practice. And you can tag me on any social media, whether it's Facebook. You can post it in Artastic Nation Facebook group that's there to support and help gain success for art teachers. Or you can tag me at Instagram, create a story, and then tag me at Ms. Artastic. Or even on Twitter, you can type it and tag me at Ms. Artastic. I would love to hear about your successes with the reflective teaching strategies and these ideas. Let me know how it's working. Well, my friends, that is the end of this podcast episode. Next week, we're going to start a two-part series where I'm going to talk about being art teacher boss and what that means, what mindsets you're going to need. As well, we'll talk about strategies for being art teacher boss. That is the end of this episode. I'm Kathleen McGivern, Ms. Artastic, signing out.